The Diary of Fate. Fate plays no favorites. It could happen to you.
31, page 512. Yes, here it is. On this page, every detail in the last days of an actor named Keith Raymond. Days that could have been full and bright, were it not for your insatiable ambition. Because that led you to a decision for evil. And now, as the ledger of your life lies open before me, I, Fate, look ahead to a single awful instant.
Here, this is the file copy.
Look, Raymond, can't we get
you to shut up? Yes, Roth. Quite a sensational account. Too bad you're not going to live to broadcast.
What? Keith, you're wrong. Wait! Wait, don't let me get away with it!
In the numbered days of Keith Raymond, a life was taken. But then I, Fate, intervened. And because of a little thing, a grain of sand, Keith Raymond now stands condemned to death. But mark well my words, you who listen, for Fate is not a conspirator in evil. In a moment, I will read again from the Diary of Fate.
Before the unusual story of Keith Raymond, here is our announcer.
Yes, in the life of Keith Raymond, a decision for evil was made. But in the end, it was a little thing that yielded the final outcome. For you see, little things, everyday trivia, are the tools with which I, Fate, mold your destiny. Remember, Keith Raymond, how it all started? You were in your dressing room following a last performance in Chicago. You were packing and listening to a broadcast by Ronald Roth, well-known radio commentator.
But now, before I turn the night off, word which comes
from
the
Broadway...
Who is it? It's me, Jargo.
Oh, I can't hear you. Wait a minute. Well, what... Oh. Well, that is, what can I do for you?
It's hard to say. We're strangers. Or are we? Seems to me we've met before.
Yes, I believe we have. Wasn't it that press party at the Lansing?
Oh, yes, that's it. Tell me, is Albert in?
Albert? Oh, Albert Winston.
Yes, I was thinking. Look, it's really quite simple. Either the man's in or he's out now, isn't it?
Well, that's hard to tell from here. You see, Albert Winston's dressing room is across the hall.
Across the hall? Uh-huh. Oh! Oh, yes, this isn't room 3, is it? How stupid of him. I'm awfully sorry, Mr. Raymond.
Huh? Yes, Keith Raymond. Sorry to say that I've forgotten your name. Look, I was listening to Ronald Roth. I want to catch the tag of his broadcast. Come in for more?
Oh, I'm listening. I think I will.
Believe me, I don't usually listen to these radio reporters. I was told today that Roth is going to have some word about the producer, Eugene Vail. You know actors.
Now, don't apologize, please. I have an interest in Eugene Vail myself.
Oh, to get my teeth into a part like that.
Oh, come now. Stop complaining about it.
No?
I saw the show tonight, and it wasn't bad at all. You were very good.
Oh, thank you. Oh, believe me, if I just had a crack at something... No, I'm sorry. I'm an awful bore when I start talk theater.
Well, in that case, I'll change the topic.
My name's Dorothy. I like your look. Remember?
What? Well, okay, it's a date, Dorothy. That's a pretty name. How does the rest of it go?
Dale. D-A-L-E.
Dale? You're not Eugene Vail's daughter.
No, dear boy, no. I'm not Eugene Vail's daughter. I'm his wife.
Yes, Keith Raymond. Because of a little thing, a mistaken room number, you met the attractive Dorothy Vail, a woman whose husband's influence could further your career. You worked hard to make sure that your first evening with her was a success. As the days turned into weeks, your meetings became more and more frequent. A month later, as you and Dorothy sped across a remote lake in a motorboat, you knew that you had played your part well. Mrs. Eugene Vail was in love with you.
Oh, this is certainly a glorious day, Dorothy.
Yes, it is. It's lovely.
Oh, now, why so glum, Dorothy, huh?
Dorothy, what is it?
It's Eugene. He'll be here in the morning, Pete.
What? Wait a minute.
Yeah, no. Have that again.
I had a wire last night. Eugene is coming here to sign his new leading man for Beyond Tomorrow.
Oh. Who was it, Dorothy? Whom did he select?
Oh, some newcomer. Young fellow named, let me see.
Hmm?
Keith Raymond.
Oh, no. Oh, no, Dorothy, you're kidding me. Not true.
Oh, it's true, all right.
Really?
I was going to tell you at dinner tonight.
Oh, but you couldn't wait. Oh, Dorothy, darling, how'd you do it?
It was easy. My husband trusts my judgment, Keith.
But, well, he doesn't know anything about us, does he?
Oh, of course not. Oh. Eugene is a jealous man, my dear. I simply told him when I saw you perform, I thought you were wonderful. There's probably a wire from him, Mr. Hostel.
Oh,
right,
darling, I can't get over this. I don't know what to say.
Try our love.
I do love you, darling.
Yes, Keith Raymond. As long as Dorothy Vail could get the lead for you in her husband's play, would tell her that you loved her. When you returned to your hotel in Chicago, you found the anticipated wire. And the next morning, you were standing before Eugene Vail, reading the closing lines of the play.
I need say no more, Catherine, you understand. By tomorrow, I'll be done. And beyond tomorrow? Beyond tomorrow, there's only dust, Freeman. Goodbye, Captain.
Splendid. Splendid, my boy. A perfect reading.
Oh, you're satisfied, Mr. Vail?
Uh-huh. That's an understatement, Raymond. Come in.
Good morning, darling. Hate to interrupt, but the chance has been killing me. That's the verdict.
Dorothy, you're a godsend. He's great in the part. By the way, do you two miss?
Oh, no. I've never been closer to Mr. Raymond than second row since.
Well, darling, this is our new star, Mr. Raymond. He's my wife, Dorothy.
How do you do, Mr. Vail?
Hello.
You two, a little less formality. We're going to be... excuse me. Hello? Who? Oh, it's you, Grant. No, I don't. And what's more, I never will have a part for you, and that's final. Great Charles Grant. Idaho's gift, Broadway.
He's a fine actor. One of the best.
Well, maybe so, Raymond, but Mr. Charles Grant has big ideas. He wants everything in sight. That seems to include my wife.
Your wife?
Yeah. Mark my words, Raymond. I made Charles Grant the star he is today. I'll break him. I'll break him if it's the last thing I ever do.
Yes, Keith. Even as Eugene Vail spoke, you made up your mind to stay away from Garth. But you found that was easier to plan than do. For you had convinced her that you were deeply in love with her. And after 2 days of avoiding Dorothy, you were unable to put her off any longer. It was Saturday morning, when you met by arrangement on a suburban bridal path.
Sorry I'm late, darling.
Please.
Traffic was terrible this morning.
Oh, dear. Did you miss me?
Yes, of course, dear. Here, let me help you down.
Thank you. Oh, it's a wonderful morning. Oh, Miss Keith, it's so good to be close to you.
I know what you mean, Dorothy, but we've got to be careful.
Keith, for how long, Keith? I can't take too much of it. Oh, dearest, why don't we face Eugene? Tell him that we
love him. No, we can't. Well, look, Dorothy. Eugene Vale made a star of me. With his help, I can go, but...
But what about me? Will I fit into your plans anymore?
Of course you do, dear. You always will. But just give me time. If I'm a success in this play, Hollywood is the next stop, and then I'm beyond Eugene Vale. But until then, Dorothy, we've got to be cautious.
Yes, Keith Raymond. You had to be careful of Eugene Vale's jealousy while the play was in rehearsal. Your first line reading with your leading lady was held that afternoon. And although Eugene Vale was not present, you were still extremely self-conscious. For you knew that Ronald Ross, the notorious radio commentator, was standing in the nearby wings. You did not know that Dorothy, too, was watching from a shadowed corner. It was then, Keith Raymond, that I, fate, intervened.
Well, Mr. Raymond, you read that scene beautifully.
Why, thank you, Audrey.
But I do have one suggestion.
Oh, really?
Here on page 10.
Oh?
According to the stage directions, you're supposed to turn on your heel and walk off quickly off your last line.
And you suggest?
Then you back off slowly as you talk.
Oh. Well, that way I'll be on to the wings when I finish, huh? Let's see. Oh, yes. Well, Catherine, I don't know how to say this, so I will...
Mr. Raymond, that loose board.
Watch out!
Keith! Keith, darling! Keith! Oh, Keith, are you all right?
Stupid fool forgot to nail that board down. Oh, my side.
Oh, sweetheart, are you hurt? Are you, dear?
No, I'm not. Dorothy, what are you doing here?
Well, Raymond, that was a nasty spill.
Huh?
Since you're not hurt badly, I can't say I'm sorry it happened.
Oh, Mr. Ross. Oh, I see what you mean. Kind of a publicity story, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, a little publicity story.
Sort of actor falls the loose board.
Not exactly, Mrs. Vale. More like actor falls for producer's wife.
Huh?
Well, so long, Keith, darling.
Yes, Keith, it was a little thing. A loose board. But because of it, you tripped. And when the woman you pretended to love forgot herself, he publicly revealed the intimacy between the two of you. Now that intimacy might soon be known to millions of radio listeners and to Eugene Vale. Soon, Keith Raymond, I will write again under your name in the Diary of Fate.
Before our story continues, here is a word on behalf of our sponsor.
You stumbled harmlessly. But that insignificant incident revealed your secret relationship with Dorothy Vale. Revealed it to Ronald Ross, a notorious gossip commentator. But a few hours later, as you drove aimlessly around Chicago with Dorothy by your side, the question of what to do about it was foremost in your mind.
All the stupid times to show emotion, Dorothy. Ronald Ross practically breathing down on us. You must have been out of your mind.
Oh, please, darling. I feel bad enough.
And what do you suggest we do about it?
I don't know.
Ah.
Oh, let's make a clean breast of the whole thing. Keith, please. We'll face the scene together. Tell him ourselves before Ross has a chance to just talk.
Now, stop it, Dorothy. Don't be a fool.
You know how he is. He'd ruin my career. He'd bar me from every theater in the country.
Well, what of it? We could get along. I have money of my own.
No, I won't do it. I will not sacrifice my career. Wait a minute. Of course, it's simple. Dorothy, there is a way out.
How, Keith? What do you mean?
It may cost us quite a lot, but it'll be cheap in the long run. Now, Ross must have a price. We'll bribe him. We'll buy him off, my dear. I'll drop you and get to his hotel right now. Good evening, Mr. Ross.
Well, hello, Raymond. I had a hunch you'd be up here tonight.
Oh? Will you invite me in?
Door's open. I'm packing, so you'll forgive me if I don't whip up a cake or something.
Going back to New York, eh? I can only stay a moment. Just long enough to ask you how much that story about me and Mrs. Vale is worth.
It's worth plenty, brother, plenty.
So I'm prepared to offer you $5,000 if you'll kill that story.
$5,000? Well, that's peanuts, Raymond. But it'll make an interesting sidelight to the story when I tell my radio audience that you tried to bribe me.
What? Oh, you dirty little...
Take your hands off me, Raymond.
Oh, you...
I warned you. There. You miserable ham, Raymond. You're a lousy actor and a lousy fighter.
Ross, you'll pay. I'll kick. Do you hear me? I'll kill you.
First bribery, now threat. You're a great source of material. Tell him what you do, Raymond. Listen in today, tomorrow, and hear my broadcast. I'm going to tell about this threat of my life right along with the rest of it. Or better yet, drop into my New York apartment around 7. I'll be working on the script then. You can help me with the details.
All right.
Now get out of here.
The burning humiliation slowly gave way to fear, Keith, as you realized the consequences of your failure to bribe Ross. Finally, in desperation, you went to Dorothy.
You realize what time it is?
I've got to talk to you right now.
It's impossible. Eugene is here. He's in the shower.
I tell you, I must talk to you, Dorothy. Things are worse than ever. Ross is...
Wait a minute. Open the door. What happened, Keith?
Oh, it's awful. Ross wouldn't be bribed. He insulted me. There was a fight. I threatened to kill him. And now he's going to broadcast the entire thing.
Oh, Keith. Well, how can we stop it?
There's only one thing we can do now. Dorothy, before Ronald Ross can make that broadcast, I'm going to kill him.
Kill him? Oh, no, please, don't ever get away. You'll never catch
me. Quiet. Hold it.
Oh.
Now, listen to me. Ross broadcast to New York, I think, tomorrow night. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to hire a private plane, fly to New York, and silence Ross for good and fly back. The whole thing will take 8 hours. There's only one problem.
What's that?
An alibi for the time I'll be gone. I've got a line rehearsal with order tomorrow from the place. I'll figure that out somewhere. Oh, you better go in now. Call you in the morning.
All right. Yes, I'm afraid.
Don't worry. Everything's going to be all right.
I hope.
Oh, well, my dear, I was beginning to worry. Where have you been?
What happened to Nelson?
You should have told me. By the way, I just got a call from Audrey. She's ill and short.
What's the matter?
Judge of Lawrence, that is. We're supposed to work lines with Raymond tomorrow. He's just there.
Yes, I know.
Look, I hate to ask, my dear, but you're the only one I can count on. Would you mind working with him tomorrow? Feed him cue.
No, that's all.
Fine, darling. And really put him through his paces. Drive him until he really knows his lines, even if it takes all night.
Yes, Kate. It was a little thing. Trivial touch of laryngitis. Yet now Dorothy could supply the perfect alibi you need. The next morning you went to a small independent airport and under an assumed name chartered a plane. At 1 o'clock you were on your way to New York. Then, just an hour later, I, fate again intervened and another little thing happened.
Don't worry, Mr. Smith. It's only 2 o'clock. We'll be there in plenty of time for your board meeting.
Splendid. Timing is important in my business. Well, the trip takes a little over 4 hours, you said, eh?
Yeah.
That should put us into New York a few minutes after 5. Yes, that'll do nicely, sir. What's that?
Hmm?
What's the matter?
I don't know.
The motor's dead. We're going to crash.
Oh, hey, take it easy.
We're going to crash.
Okay, take it easy. We just passed an emergency field. We've still got plenty of altitude to make
right.
it. I'll set it down there. Take it easy.
Oh, great heavens, man. Now, can't you hurry? You've been working in that motor for a couple of hours.
Doing the best I can with... Well, I'm trying to be important.
Important? Oh, you couldn't possibly realize.
Well, I found out what was wrong anyway.
What?
Grain of sand in the needle valve. Here, look at it.
You mean that little grain of sand?
Yeah, that's what did it. Oh. I'll have her back together in no time now, Mr. Smith. Sure hope we're not going to be too late.
Yes, Keith. It was nothing more than a tiny grain of sand. Yet it completely upset your carefully planned schedule. Finally, the plane was repaired. And when the Manhattan skyline at last came into view, you glanced nervously at your watch for the 100th time. It was 7:00. It took less than a half hour by taxi to get from the airport to Ross's apartment. Your watch said just 7:30 when you arrived. Without knocking, he tried his door and found it open.
Who's there? Is someone Raymond.
Yes. Remember, you invited me to help with the sale. Yeah, I got here just in time. You can take your hat and coat off again, Ross. You're not going anywhere.
What are you talking about? What are you... A gun. Now, Raymond, you're out of your mind.
Shut up. I'll do the talking now. Certain speech in this little drama belongs to me. There's a script there in your pocket.
You'll never get away with this.
Yes, I will. You know, I thought of everything. Now the carbon copy of the pocket.
Listen, Raymond.
Come on, Ross. Move.
Okay. Okay. Here. This is the file copy. Look, Raymond.
I told you to shut up. This story's separate. That's convenient. Remove these pages about Dorothy and me. No one will ever know they're gone. It's quite a sensational account, Ross. Too bad you're not going to let the broadcast.
What? Keith, you're wrong. I just... Wait. Wait, you'll never get away with it. Stop.
You stared at his body lying at your feet. Then, as excited voices rose outside in the hall, you fled to the service entrance. A half hour later, you were seated again in the chartered plane. You were certain now that in a few short hours, you would be back in Chicago and safe. But my hand... The hand of fate is inexorable, Keith Raymond. As inexorable as the passing of time. Soon I will report again, but the final entry under your name in the diary of fate.
Before the surprising conclusion of the story of Keith Raymond, here is our announcer.
Keith Raymond, now you had nothing to worry about. Ronald Ross was dead, and you had a perfect alibi for all the time you were gone. When the plane landed in Chicago, you drove to your apartment where you knew Dorothy would be waiting.
Here you are, cabbie. Keep the check.
That's him. He's your man, officer. That's Keith Raymond.
What? Mr. Vail, Dorothy, what's...
I'm Detective Lieutenant Simmons, homicide, Raymond. You care to tell us where you've been just now? Hmm?
Why, we were rehearsing. I just stepped out for a breath of air.
And... Oh, Keith, it's no news.
Dorothy.
Why did you come back here?
Be quiet, Dorothy.
Yeah, she's right. Been waiting here almost 4 hours. Since they found Ross's body, they put out a call for you.
For me?
Yep.
Why me? I don't understand.
Ross told the whole country you'd threatened to kill him. He said if he turned up dead, you'd be the guy to get. It's a big story on his broadcast.
On his rock?
Yes.
Oh, no, that's impossible. Ross didn't broadcast tonight. He couldn't have.
Huh?
The program's on at 8 o'clock. It was only 7:30 when I...
When you killed him? That's where you're wrong, Raymond. You forget to set your watch ahead when you change time zone. It's 7:30 Chicago time. It's 8:30 New York. So you didn't kill Ross before his broadcast. You killed him just after it.
In the shock of your hopeless blunder, Keith, you confess the whole thing. Soon now you will be executed for murder. And Dorothy, through her disloyalty to her husband, faces divorce, scandal, and a life empty of all but bitterness and remorse. And now it is time to close the book. In the case of Keith Raymond, as in the cases of all mortals, I, fate, am but the instrument of a plan. A plan that even I cannot alter. For I am but the instrument. And the numberless little things that happen are the tools with which I work. Keith Raymond made a decision for evil. Then I, fate, intervened. And because of a little thing, a grain of sand, his timetable for murder was upset. And because of another little thing, because he forgot to set his watch ahead, he will pay for his crime with his life. Heed well the moral, you who listen. And remember, there is a page for you in the Diary of Fate.
Our cast included Lorraine Tuttle, Larry Dobkin, George Neese, Herbert Lytton, Ray Erlenborn, Clay Sanders, and Hal Sawyer.